As either you know or read, I'm Reverend Carol Devine, and I am the minister for Green Chalice, and I also serve on the regional Christian Church in Kentucky staff, and I'm also working in admissions at Lexington Theological Seminary. And so welcome all of you by all of those entities, and give great thanks that you're here. I won't go into who Green Chalice is and the history of Green Chalice, because I feel like everybody on here knows that or knows how to get that. So we're going to jump on in to our topic. But I wanted to start by, you know, just acknowledging a couple of things. One is that I'm a white woman of privilege, dealing with a subject that's really, in some ways, not my story to tell. And yet, because we are mostly a white audience, it is mine to share with my family in that way. But I just want to speak that I've witnessed it, but I have not lived the effects of environmental racism. And so I just want to name that. I also just want to point out to all of us that this is a really hard subject for all of you who are in the Poor People's Campaign, hearing the stories of people who are living in poverty and the effects of, you know, mining and lack of health insurance and housing that isn't livable. This is all tough stuff. So I want to just acknowledge first that it is hard, right? And that we have to come into these subjects, or I have to come into these subjects, and I would invite you to as well, with an open heart, knowing that this is too much for any of us, but that because we carry God in us, that we can take hard stuff in, and with God's power, strength, love, we are able to transform it, right? So we have those breath prayers that many of us have done or at least know about, where we, you know, breathe in God's love, we breathe in God's peace, but we can also breathe out God's love and peace, because God is in us, in our very breath and in our body. And so this is hard, and I invite you to come to this with an open heart. One of the things that I've been trying to do in 2020 more than any other year is to be able to just be open to something that's maybe different, very different than my own experience, or even something that I've ever seen. And so because it isn't my experience, and because I haven't lived that truth, it's really hard for me sometimes to take it in, because as a white person of privilege, I feel like the fingers being pointed at me a little bit. And so what I invite us to do instead is to, one, remember that Jesus calls us into uncomfortable places. And so I remind myself that if I'm uncomfortable, if I'm being stretched, I'm probably right where I need to be. Two, that we aren't alone, that we're in a community right here on Zoom today, part of a bigger body of Christ, but also that we all individually carry God and God's power in us. And so we can handle hard stuff. So I would just invite us to realize that, to try to be open as we enter into this hard stuff. Some of it you will have heard of and know, and some of it might be new. But I want to acknowledge that as a pastor first. So let's start in prayer. Most gracious and loving God, we breathe in your spirit, we breathe out your spirit. Help us to be like a horn, a flute, or some kind of horned instrument, or instrument that's hollow inside, where we just allow you and your spirit and your power to flow through us. God, walk with us and guide us and help us to take in this hard stuff, knowing that while we can't handle it alone, that with your power and in community, that is your body, that we can. Give us peace in this very difficult time. Give us health. Bless us. and all those who are suffering today with COVID, all those who are suffering today due to effects of racism and all kinds of injustice. And we lift up all those who are already suffering from the climate catastrophe that we are experiencing all over this planet. God, give us your power that we might be your change agents in all that we do. It is in Christ's name we pray. Amen. And so as we get started, I would invite us to stay muted until there will be times that I'll say, you know, if you want to unmute yourself, please feel free. But if you can just check and make sure that you stay muted, because it can cause some issues with background and that kind of thing, that would be wonderful. So let's begin this portion by just talking about what it is. Environmental racism is an affliction where communities comprised of persons of color and or low-income people are adversely affected by government, institutional, or industrial practices or policies that either negatively affect or withhold the benefits of clean air, water, soil, and natural spaces. These communities are more likely to have food deserts, which we'll talk about a little bit more in a minute, waste and toxic hazardous facilities. So this definition actually comes from the resolution on environmental racism that Green Chalice sponsored in 2015. This term was actually coined by a pastor. It was coined by Benjamin Chavez, previous executive director of the UCC Commission for Racial Justice addressing hazardous PCB waste in Warren County, North Carolina. He defined the term as racial discrimination in environmental policy, making the enforcement of regulations and laws, the deliberate targeting of communities of color for toxic waste facilities, the official sanctioning of the life-threatening presence of poisons and pollutants in our communities, and the history of excluding people from color from leadership of the ecological movements. And I just want to pause here for that last part of that, the history of excluding people of color from leadership of the ecological movements. One of the things that I've known, but I have really delved into and prayed about and tried to wrestle with, if you will, this year is our own denomination and the environmental racism that is evident in our denomination. And let me explain. Green Chalice has been active in Kentucky since 2007. This is where we started. And we have been part of the entire denomination since May of 2011. Green Chalice has the entire time first just had one very part-time minister, which is myself. And then we were able to add another very part-time minister, which is Reverend Scott Hardinieri, who is in Asheville, North Carolina. Both of us are white. The whole time that Green Chalice has been active in Kentucky, it was a volunteer organization, with some of the folks who were on this call helped get it started. But then when it went to the whole denomination, we have always had little to no budget. And every year has been a struggle to know, are we going to have enough money just to do the little minimum things that we do. So that lack of funding has caused us to do a lot of great work for churches and regions who can pay for us before COVID, who could pay for us to come there, basically. And those are white churches. And so that means that our poorer congregations, particularly those of Black and Brown brothers and sisters, have not had access in the same way to Green Chalice and to the workshops that we do and the trainings that we do, but even to the resources. We have have added a little bit of Spanish resources, but we haven't even had the financial wherewithal to be able to translate everything into Spanish or Korean or the many other languages that Disciples of Christ speak across the United States and Canada. So I just want to, sometimes I have read environmental racism as out there, as in urban areas or as some other place, and in Louisville, Kentucky, for instance, not here in Lexington, Kentucky, and not part of this denomination that I love so very much. And yet I cannot deny that not only has happened, but continues to happen as we are not able to be present to the poorer churches, if you will, to churches that have less funds, less wealth, which means we are continuing to support and lift up our white churches. So I just wanted to name that. So our goal here is environmental justice, which is the fair treatment and meaningful involvement of all people, regardless of race, color, national origin, or income, with respect to the development, implementation, and enforcement of environmental laws. And I also need to say that because I'm not able to check the chat while I'm also doing this, if you have, like, I will have time for discussion and questions and answers, but if there's something that you're like, oh, I really need to know that, then please just unmute yourself and holler at me, because I'm not able to pay attention to the chat right now. So we come to this, obviously, we all know this, but I like to name it. We come to this with theological grounding, that we are called to do this work, right? Jesus calls us into those hard places and to those places that we often don't want to go, that we aren't comfortable with, don't feel good, to work with people that are not necessarily like us. And so we know that. And we know that it is all grounded, all of our justice work is grounded in Scripture. So throughout the Hebrew Bible and the New Testament, from the very beginning of Genesis, when God's spirit breath as ruach went out over the waters, imbuing everything with sacredness, with divinity, all the way to Revelation, where we have this vision of a beautiful a beautiful kingdom of God, that where there are, you know, trees and beautiful waters. And so all throughout, we are called to care for the earth because it is God's, that we are called to do justice, and we are called to love and care for our neighbor, our siblings, widows and orphans, the least of these among us. And you all know these scriptures. I actually normally have a slide that has these scriptures listed, but I cut those out so that we might have more time to talk about this stuff instead. So here we go. I don't know about you all, but when if I were to have drawn a picture of my house as a kid, it might have looked something like this, one of these. It would have had green grass. There might have been a swing set, but we would have had, you know, a bird, and you can see sunshine and all these, and blue skies, and we have clouds and butterflies. And as a pastor, I was a teacher before I was called to ministry. So as a teacher and pastor, one of the things that I know to be true is that children who grow up connected to the earth, who dig in the dirt, and who play outside, come to know God in a way that nobody can take away from them, right? So even children who never go to church, even children who never read the Bible or have the Bible read to them, when they are outside, noticing the changing of the seasons, when they are experiencing the death and resurrection that is season changes and critters and all of that, there is a connection that happens in our spirits that is really important. It's really important for all of us, and we know that those of us who had those experiences as children can come back to that even when everything else falls apart in our lives. So even if things don't work out with our family of origin, even if something negative happens at school, even if there becomes abuse and violence in our lives, when we have that actual literal connection to the earth and to the sacredness of it, that is something that we can come back to over and over and over and over throughout our whole lives. And there's a whole movement now of ecotherapy and just realizing that that is really important, because we know that there are huge positive effects of being in nature, and particularly of growing up with that connection. So we know that it's good for our physical health, of course, but also our mental, and very much for our spiritual health. And we know that there have been lots of studies now that when we go hiking in forests or any wild spaces, which would include the sea or deserts or meadows, et cetera, when we are in the wilderness 45 minutes a week, or with some regularity, that we are calmer, that we have less anxiety, that we just have more peace. But it also, those effects are also maybe not quite as profound as when we're in the wilderness, but we also see those positive effects when we have parks and green spaces, our own backyards or front yards, or a park near the house that we can walk to. We know that trees have a powerful and very healing effect on us when we live near or under them, when we're able to walk among them, sit under them, and that kind of thing. And probably everybody on the Zoom tonight feels that, have had those experiences. When we're feeling stressed, we try to get outside. We try to get near water or go hiking and that kind of thing. So this is really important. We know this from research, but also from our own experiences. And yet here's a house of drawing of a little girl who lives in an urban area, right? And what we notice is that there isn't color, there isn't the sky and the trees and the beautiful butterflies. And so that urban experience is void, oftentimes, sometimes completely void of any green spaces, of trees, of creeks to throw rocks in, and parks to play in that are safe. And so what does that mean for their health? What does that mean for their emotional health? What does that mean for their spiritual health? We know that it isn't good. And one of the things that we know is an effect of growing up or living in places like that drawing that little girl had, is that the surface temperature is much higher, 10 to 20 degrees higher than areas that are very green and lush and have trees and grass, etc. This is actually, unfortunately, Lexington, Kentucky was, I believe it was one of the top 10 cities that had such a profound example of environmental racism in terms of heat. So you can see that these areas here, the darker the red, the hotter it is in the summertime. And then you can see the this one is income. The green one is the income. The darker the green, the higher the income, the lower the whiter it is, the lower the income. And so you can see that the same areas that are very low income are the areas that are much hotter in the summer. Why is that important? Because we know that heat-related illnesses are actually, in some parts of the US, the number one way that people get sick and die. And it's a growing all over the United States as the climate catastrophe continues to increase. This becomes more and more and more and more of a problem. So when we grow up in these dark red areas, then that means that we're more likely to have asthma, that we're more likely to have all kinds of breathing kinds of issues, but also our elderly population, it's very hard on them, and very young children. We also know then, obviously, that is going to take a lot more air conditioning if they have air conditioning, which takes a lot more energy, which then continues the whole problem of the climate catastrophe that we are in. How did we get here? How did we get to the place where Lexington, Kentucky has such a drastic, such a great example of environmental racism in terms of heat? It's all grounded in racism, but particularly for housing, it goes back to what is known as redlining. In 1933, faced with a housing shortage, the federal government began a program designed to increase America's housing stock. Housing programs begun under the New Deal resulted in state-sponsored system of segregation. The FHA, which was established in 1934, furthered the segregation efforts by refusing to insure mortgages in or near African-American neighborhoods, and that's a policy known as redlining. They had maps of every city in America, and they would color code all of the neighborhoods, and any neighborhoods that were African-American or next to or near an African-American neighborhood would be red. And the mortgage and insurance, the insurance for mortgages were not allowed to give insurance in those areas. At the same time, the FHA was subsidizing builders who were mass producing entire subdivisions for whites only. The requirement was, yes, build that neighborhood. Yes, insure those houses. Let's get people living there. But none of them were allowed to be sold to African Americans. And so that, for many of us who haven't known this particular thing or just hadn't really sat and thought about it, we're still feeling the effects of these policies, right? And dealing with other ones as well. The term redlining comes from the New Deal, the federal government's maps of every metropolitan area in the country. Maps were color-coded by the Home Owners Loan Corp and then the Federal Housing Administration, and it was also adopted by the Veterans Administration. These color codes indicated where it was safe to insure mortgages. Anywhere African Americans lived or lived nearby were color-coded red to indicate that appraisers, that these neighborhoods were too risky to insure the mortgage. In Detroit, this is a true story, a white developer wanted to build a housing development near a black neighborhood, but he couldn't get a loan. So he built a 6-foot-tall, half-mile-wide, long wall between the black neighborhood and the property that he wanted to build on, and he was able then to get the loan. And so I want to pause for just a minute and let some of this that I've just said soak in while we just listen to the song by Marvin Gaye. I had not.
On the oceans and upon our seas, fish full of mercury. Oh, oh, mercy, mercy, me. All things ain't what they used to be. Radiation underground and in the sky, animals and birds who live nearby our lives. All things and what they used to be. What about this overcrowded land? How much more we use from men? Can't you stand? Oh, no.
So some of the lyrics here, where did all the blue skies go? Poison is the wind that blows from the north and south and east. Oil wasted on the oceans and upon our seas, fish full of mercury, radiation underground and in the sky. Animals and birds who live nearby are dying. What about this overcrowded land? How much more abuse from man can she stand? And again, this is 1971. So the effects of environmental racism, and this is not an exhaustive list, but the thing that we see first, if we go into Black and low-income neighborhoods, is lack of green space, lack of safe play spaces, and healthy, safe soil in many, I don't want to say most because I don't know the statistics, but in many low-income neighborhoods, it isn't safe to plant a garden because the soil isn't safe and there's toxicities in it. We notice that there are few or no trees. We notice that, going back to that food desert, that there are few or no supermarkets. If they have any markets, they are often small, kind of convenience stores that, as you know, everything costs way more in a convenience store than in a supermarket, but also that there then therefore isn't fresh and healthy foods like we have in the supermarket. That we also notice that farmers markets are generally not set up, you know, in those urban or low income neighborhoods. We notice that there's more pollution, toxicity of all kinds in the air and the water and the soil, that there's more trash. There are abandoned and unsafe lots, boarded up homes, which also means more violence and drugs and fear. And as we've already talked about, heat. There are more, there is more precedence or more incidence, excuse me, of cancer and other illnesses like asthma. We notice that there are more problems, neurobehavioral problems and learning disabilities. And some of us can think of Flint, Michigan and the horrific situation that is still there. There are hormone and reproductive problems that result in deformities and disabilities. There is higher stress and anxiety. The death rates are higher and the life expectancy is lower. And then just, you know, this year, of course, we are so much of that COVID has pulled back, you know, the blankets, if you will, the that have maybe covered some of these from our own eyes, as we have seen that our Black and brown brothers and sisters, siblings have higher rates of COVID, but more importantly, higher rates of death from COVID. And only because they are Black and brown and because their access to healthcare their whole lives has been different than ours, and that the levels of stress, no matter where they live, are higher, but particularly if they live in these urban and low-income areas. So what can we do? Well, the first is just to educate ourselves and talk with others, right? And you all have shown up. So I'm preaching to the choir here, of course, which is always the case. But I think I think 2020 has been, you know, a horrible year, and none of us would claim that it's been good, but we can, you know, good things come out of really difficult situations, and God has revealed a lot to us. And I would say that there has been more education on, particularly on racism in 2020 than I've ever seen. And so we have to just continue to be open to that. Again, this is hard stuff. It gets exhausting. It's emotional. We acknowledge that and we take care of ourselves, but we also know that we aren't alone and that we are in this together and that we can, with God's help, do really hard things. We have to educate ourselves, but we also need to talk with others about these things, because just because we know about it doesn't mean that other people are doing that work. And our friends and family and neighbors and can benefit also from just knowing some of these things. we need to make new friends and stand with and love our siblings and neighbors. So that can be more difficult during COVID, obviously, but that needs to be a part of our opening to this, is hearing perspectives that are very different from ours, of hearing about experiences that are very different from ours. And sometimes those experiences and perspectives are so foreign, are so different than what we have experienced and come to know, that it doesn't make sense. Like, how can this be true? And yet we have to be open to trusting that our Black and brown and low income siblings are sharing out of their own experiences. And even though it's mind blowing because it shouldn't happen, it is happening, it has happened. And it's important for us to hear those stories, to hear their stories, which is also going back to, yes.
One comment sent to me just now was Black and brown have the low income and essential jobs also.
Yes, thank you very much. And that is a very important point that we have been talking about and seeing in the news, especially, and in our communities, as those of us who can go and pick up our groceries or have our groceries delivered, it is only because our Black and brown and low-income siblings are doing that work for us, which then puts them at more risk, you know, for COVID and lower income. Yes. So listening to those stories is really important. And the Poor People's Campaign is a place that we really can hear those stories. And for those of you who are at that, that's, if you've ever been to a Poor People's Campaign, that is one thing that is really beautiful about it, is that we don't hear, you know, the educated people, if you will, the white people talking about these things, but people get to tell their own story. And what that feels like. So that's a really important movement that I hope that you will learn more about and show up for. We have got to advocate for new laws. These are going to be sometimes they're national laws, but sometimes these are community laws. So we need to know when there's a pipeline going in, let's say, and where is it that they're planning to put it. You know, we oftentimes pay attention because we think, oh, it's not going to be in my neighborhood. Well, it's in somebody's neighborhood. So we need to know where these toxic wastes or where the new trash dump is going to be, or where that pipeline is going to be, etc. We are called to stand for all of our brothers and sisters, all of our siblings, and not just for our immediate family, right? So knowing what's going on in your community is an important thing. Supporting urban tree programs. There is one in Lexington called Tree Lexington, but they are happening all around our state and our nation. Supporting urban garden programs. Again, I talked about the fact that most of the time in these areas, the soil isn't safe. And so these urban garden programs haul in compost and dirt so that there can be gardens that are safe. And we'll talk about one example in just a minute. And then support building green spaces and play spaces for our children, for people of all ages, to throw a frisbee, right? Or for the children to have a playground on, for people to have a safe place where they can go and be outside. So supporting those. When we have these abandoned lots, well, that's a great place for the city to, you know, put in and support those programs, volunteer for them, support them financially, et cetera. Work to clean up trash and toxic waste. Obviously, we have to be careful, particularly during COVID, of course, but always we have to be careful to not just go and start picking up trash in a place that might have hazardous waste, toxic waste, or unsafe things like broken glass, needles, etc. So I am not advocating that you just get gung-ho and go out and clean up, but there are programs that we can participate in that are safe. And then working for clean waterways. This is just continuing to be a really important issue. We know how to make our creeks and streams and rivers clean. We know the processes that need to happen. And there are organizations like River Keepers, and actually there's a ton of different organizations that work on this, but knowing what they do, showing up for a cleanup day, or again, donating to them, these are great activities for our churches to get involved in. And then the last one is that we have got to support our Black and Brown banks and businesses of all sorts. One of the, I won't get into all that, but there are lists in all of our communities. And if there aren't enough, or if there isn't any in yours, then try to find out, connect with Black leaders in your community to know, how can we help? How can we help support? Because one of the things we know is that when all of us are empowered for our own future and destiny, then we make the best decisions for us. Right? And so we know that that is also true of our Black and Brown siblings. However, they have had so many obstacles, legal racism, that institutional racism that has kept them from being able to always make these empowerment decisions for their community. We have got to get behind them and help support that. And that's something that I know many of us are doing more and more and more now. And so I give thanks for that. So what is, I'm sorry.
This is another question. Could you embellish a little more about how water is made clean?
I can talk a little bit. I think Kim Coward's on here. She probably can say more, but we know that along waterways, when instead of it being clear cut so that it's like just grass and then creek, what is safer is to have grasses, tall grasses of all sorts, trees. And I'm not a water person, but I know that there is a whole there's experts who do this, right? So it involves grasses and trees and keeping those areas as a filter, so that as water rushes from our parking lots and streets and all of the gunk that it picks up along the way, that there's a filter system as it nears our waterways is the short version. And if anybody wants to pipe in, they're welcome to. Okay, what has Green Chalice done? In 2015, we authored and sponsored a resolution concerning environmental racism, which was passed unanimously. To be honest, going into it, I had no idea if what kind of reception it would get, but it was completely supported by everyone in the room, as far as we could tell anyway. You can find that in many places, but one of them is at our website, greenchalice.org. There's a tab that is called Resources, and under the Resources page, there are all of our resolutions. And so if you, in case you didn't know, every resolution, the first two numbers are the year. So 15 means 2015, and then 20 was the number that it was at that assembly. So GA 1520 was the resolution concerning environmental racism. And it's a really great document, because it gives some foundation as to why is this important. And then we have a lot of resources at the end of it that are still 5 years later, you know, pertinent and helpful. We did a lot of workshops right after that. From 2015 to 2017, we did a lot of workshops and presentations like this one. But then this year in 2020, we've been asked again to do more of this. So we have done workshops at regional and general assemblies, but also at ecumenical conferences. Just in February, right before the shutdown, I did a presentation like this in North Carolina for an ecumenical conference. We have, and I again, I want to lift this up, not as a woe is me or woe is Green Chalice, but because I continue to be very concerned about the environmental racism that I'm participating in Green Chalice. We applied for two grants so far in 2020. Which specifically were for Green Chalice to provide more resources, financial resources, but also just our education and trainings for disciples churches that are located in low-income neighborhoods, particularly churches that are in an environmentally fragile areas, so along the coast particularly, and neither were approved. Now, just like as a person of color, you might go to a store and have a negative experience and you're not sure was that just that person was having a bad day and anybody would have had a bad experience, or was that racism? That's how I'm seeing this. I don't know. It may very well be that there were just much better other ways to spend the money. But what we see over time, right, not just Green Chalice, but all over time, is that this is consistently an issue. That when we are trying to do programs specifically for Black and Brown siblings, and then it's doesn't get the same money, doesn't have the same. Yeah. So anyway, just lifting that up, not as a woe is me, but as we need to be more aware as disciples of Christ. We advocate in our own communities, but also nationally with Creation Justice Ministries for better legislation. And that is ongoing and will continue as long as, I guess, we have breath. Green Chalice supports and encourages others to support urban tree planting. So we have been involved with urban tree planting, but we also continually lift up wherever we are for folks to get involved in that. And we educate and support community gardens. And so many disciples congregations across the United States and in Canada have community gardens where either people from the community come in and are gardening, or the produce from it is taken to those who need, or they help support our food banks. So there are many different ways that community gardens can be carried out and used, but it is one of the beautiful things that disciples are doing all over the US and Canada. I wanted to lift up some positive things, and again, these are just a couple of examples that I wanted to lift up to you. But there are wonderful tree planting urban forestry programs, and this one happened to be in North Carolina, and you can see that Delta Airlines and Duke University did a program. It was 100% funded, and they went out and planted a whole bunch of trees in urban areas. One of my favorite organizations in the whole world is Seed Leaf. It's an organization, a community garden organization here in Lexington, Kentucky, that brings in healthy soil and particularly builds gardens in areas that that are urban and don't have safe soil, and maybe perhaps there isn't the space, the green spaces, in order to have those. But there are programs like this all over, but this just happens to be one that I love. And I also would just lift up that last year, at the end of 2019, that New York City passed the most progressive environmental justice law that we have ever seen in the United States. And the thing that you can Google it and read all about it, but the thing that I wanted to lift up is that it, instead of it being the hires up who designed and came up with this program and said, here's what we're going to do, it started from the get-go with our Black and Brown siblings as part of the process. And there's an accountability that community gets to hold. So I'm sure it isn't perfect, but it is kind of a shining star in environmental justice. So just wanted to lift that up. And then we have, it looks like 9 minutes for a little discussion, and I'll stop sharing my screen. But first I wanted to say thank you all for all showing up. It is a Friday night and there's lots of other things that you might want to be doing. So I thank you for showing up. I encourage you to reach out to me if you have questions, or if there's any way that I can serve you. And then also just reemphasize that our website is greenchalice.org, which is really easy to remember, and that we have lots of resources there, and you can always link to myself and Scott for more help and that kind of thing. So I'm going to go. Now I can see you all. It's a lot harder when you're trying to look at two things at once. So we have now 8 minutes, and I wanna really respect everybody's time, but I would just invite you to, if you have a comment or question, that you would just kind of unmute yourself, because I don't have any way to really call on you, and I can't even see everybody. Some of you just have names. So anybody have a question or a comment or?
Carol, this is Rachel. I was just wondering, what's a good place to start for our churches?
Well, you know, one of the things I want to be really careful about, and one of the things that makes disciples so great, is that we all have our own passions, right? And so some churches' passions are food. And so then, you know, maybe a community garden or that kind of thing, or maybe the location. You know, First Christian Church Owensboro, before they burned down, had an incredible community garden, but they didn't even garden it. They opened it up to literally the community and said, hey, you come and you get to plant it. This is your garden. This is your space. Some of our churches are located in areas where that is such a gift, right? Just get it going, you know, turn over the soil, get a garden going, and then talk to the community and say, this is for you. Or like I said, there's many ways to do community gardens. So community gardens are a wonderful thing, but being involved in tree planting, raising this issue up, getting to know our neighbors. It really, our churches, I feel like we all have our passions. Some churches, it may be women and children. So there may be support and programs that you want to do for that. Some, it might be seniors. And so I know that Cynthiana Christian, that they have always had an enormous community garden, but it isn't at their church. It's kind of out of town, but their ministry is taking that produce and delivering it to seniors, particularly seniors who otherwise wouldn't be able to get it. So it's hard for me to answer that, Rachel. So I always encourage, in anything having to do with Green Chalice, there isn't a step one, step two, step three. It's like, where do you feel the Spirit moving, right? Where do you feel the Spirit moving? What is the passion of your church? If you were to say, our church is, this is who we are, go that route, right? Lean into that. Are there others?
Eric, I want to make sure you saw, and Eric, you might be asking this. There was a question in the chat saying the slides are excellent. Carol, would you be willing to somehow share these as a PDF or whatnot? That might be something the region can help with too, or you may have that already out there.
Yeah, sure. I don't have it out there, but I would be happy. I would be happy.
Yeah, I learned so much. I learned so much. So thank you for that. You know, the thought that occurs to me is how I just think about our daughter. This is such a passion of hers, and I wonder if there isn't an opportunity for congregations that are in some cases maybe looking to restart or at least restoke youth ministry, if Green Chalice isn't an opportunity, if there isn't an intersection there, and Green Chalice be a strong way to reach some kids that we maybe typically wouldn't.
Absolutely. To be honest, there have been congregations that the Green Chalice Ministry was started by the youth group. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, Green Chalice, we have an eco-justice camp for youth and adults, but mostly for youth each summer, where we lift that up. And we have a grant that we haven't heard about yet that hopes to support and broaden that. So we'll see. Mm-hmm. We'll see if we're going to be one for three or zero for three, we'll see. I would say that is important. And I would say I was the pastor at Providence Christian for 8 years. And one of the things that we did with the youth while I was there was we did a whole unit on racism, and just, you know, helped listen to them and what their experiences were from a white perspective, white middle class perspective, and then really stretched each other. And went and had some experiences, et cetera, that then we also went to the Eco Justice Camp. I can't speak enough about that Eco Justice Camp that we have at Christmount every summer, you all. It is an incredible camp. Bowling Green has come, Providence, and then I think those are the only two churches in Kentucky that I can think of. But it's wonderful for youth pastors because you just show up and you get to participate, but you don't have to, you know, lead it. It's at Christmount, which that's really nice. We try to keep the cost really, really low. And you have both fun experiences in nature, like hiking, and we do rafting or kayaking, and really stretch ourselves with environmental racism as well as other environmental issues and justice issues. So just give a big plug for that one. Thank you, Eric. Are there other questions? Again, I don't want to keep you all.
Hey, Carol, this is Gene Kasten. I kind of have two questions, and I hate to throw politics into the mix, but
okay.
I'm going to ask anyway. Okay. So are there any legislative issues that you're all pushing for within the state or the local communities? And if so, could you give an example of some of the things that you're trying to press for change and improvement in Kentucky? And the second question is just curious to know kind of where you all stand with any type of alignment with the Green New Deal or any aspects of that on a national level.
Okay, so I'm going to start with the second one first, and that is that I personally am very supportive of the Green New Deal. However, Green Chalice is not, we aren't political, and there are some disciples who, across the country, who have a lot of struggles with it, so we aren't, as an organization, you know, pro or against, but we are in environmental catastrophe, right? We are in climate catastrophe. We're not even talking about climate change anymore. And we're not even really talking about climate crisis anymore because we're already in catastrophe. We can look at the amount of hurricanes. We can look at the fires. We're already there, right? And so acting as if this is something that we can wait and see, we're way past that eight ball. And so I'm no longer gentle about that. That's just where we are. That's the science, and we all are experiencing and seeing it. So we have got to have some legislation that is very forward thinking, and we've got to make a lot of progress in a very short amount of time. We now have nine years in order to make changes that we are not on track to make. So personally, yes, Green New Deal, whatever we need to do, let's do that. We know that because of COVID, another wonderful thing that COVID has shown us is that in a very short amount of time, a lot of money can be thrown at something, and we as Americans can change our behavior like that. So that's what needs to happen for the climate catastrophe that we're currently experiencing if we're at all going to turn this huge ship around. In terms of legislation currently having to do with environmental racism, I don't know right now. We have in the past, Green Chalice in partnership with Kentucky Council of Churches and Kentucky Interfaith Power and Light have worked really hard to, I don't know if you remember the Bluegrass Pipeline that they were trying to bring in through communities. We successfully fought and stopped that from happening just a few years ago. So that was one that the faith community really rallied around, and that was a big win for us. But I would say that all of us in our individual communities need to be asking these questions about what's going on in our communities of color and in our low-income neighborhoods, and what do we need to do in order to not just help protect them, but help to bring life and healing into those. I don't know if that's helpful or not, but I also would encourage us to pay attention. The Poor People's Campaign has their finger on that, the Kentucky Poor People's Campaign, also the Kentucky Council of Churches, and also Kentucky Interfaith Power and Light. They're all our faith legislative in Kentucky organizations. Thank you, Jean. Okay, so it is actually past time. So unless somebody has a, like something they need to say, or they're not gonna be able to go to sleep tonight. Otherwise, you all know how to reach me. And I welcome your emails, your calls, your texts, and I give great thanks for you all being here today. And just remember that we can't do this alone, but together as community, as body of God, and as people of faith who carry Christ's power inside of us, we can do this. It's not too much. So thank you all. Blessings, and hopefully see you in the morning.